Psalm 83 is an Arab-Israeli war predicted about 3,000 years ago by King Asaph, King David's worship leader. And these are the populations that it would involve if it is about to find fulfillment. I call them in Israelistein an inner circle, and they're inside of this pentagon here, superimposed upon their modern-day equivalents. In contrast, Ezekiel 38 and 39, I call an outer circle, and they are involving the countries you see on the upper left. The general consensus is would be Russia, Turkey, Iran, Libya, and you see some names up there. And again, I'll be going into more detail of this. Here's a comparative map to Psalm 83. You see the Pentagon there. Now, I have these maps, by the way, on my table. They're for free for you, and they're inside of my books. But so I'll be talking about those two prophecies tomorrow, and you can see there's a big difference inside of the Pentagon in Psalm 83, and outside of it is the outer circle of Ezekiel 38. So what about Iran in 2012? So I was joking about 2012 being the end of the year, but in reality, 2012 could be a very, very powerful year still, especially in the Middle East, and it could get nuclear, and that's the concern. And the prophecies I'm going to talk to you about today could find fulfillment even this year. We're that close, in my estimation. And it was said by the Defense Minister Barak that 2012 is the year of the fight against the Iranian nuclear program. And it's not a matter of weeks, he said, but it's also not a matter of years either. So he's already pointed out it could be 2012 is the year that they're going to deal with Iran. Leon Panetta had come out earlier this year. Many of you may have heard this quote leaked out through David Ignatius. And he suspected that there was a strong likelihood that Israel would strike Iran in either April, May, or June. Well, of course, we're in July now, so that hasn't happened. But what's most important is that he's talked about this zone of immunity that Israel is watching closely. Israel is watching the elections. Many of us believe Netanyahu will initiate the attack of Iran before Obama could get reelected, because many of us don't believe he wants Obama to be reelected. There's speculation that he's a pretty good friend of Mitt Romney's, but I'm not so sure about how well they know each other. But this zone of immunity is what Israel's watching. It's what this is. It's a situation where if they struck Iran's nuclear programs, they would have little to no effect on their attack, and it would be very risky for them to do this, and no results that they could calculate. And Iran is rapidly approaching this. Matter of fact, credible U.S. sources estimate that Iran could have a nuclear weapon in about 4 months. So when we talk about Iran in the end times, Bible prophecy, most people immediately jump to Ezekiel 38 and 39. How many are you familiar with Ezekiel 38 and 39, the Gog and Magog invasion? Great. It's always great to teach at a prophecy conference and see all those hands go up. I've spoken to many churches where about 10% of the hands go up, and they're not taught this stuff. Well, most of you are probably familiar with Persia in Ezekiel 38 and 39. How many of you are familiar with the prophecies of Elam in Jeremiah 49, verses 34 through 39, which is also dealing with modern-day Iran? See, the map up here of modern-day Iran, when Ezekiel wrote, and he had a contemporary named Jeremiah, it encompassed Elam and Persia, not just Persia. So we're going to get our mind around the fact that there may be a double jeopardy for Iran in addition to Ezekiel 38 and Jeremiah 49. Now, let me show you where Elam is. This is a map of Elam. It was Elam was the son of Shem. He was Noah's oldest son. His capital city was Susa, which was about 150 miles north of the Persian Gulf. And we're told in Genesis 14, 1 through 9, that they were warlike people. When Abraham went to rescue his nephew Lot, King Chedorlaomer was the king of Elam. So you've heard of him way back in the book of Genesis. That was in chapter 14. In Isaiah 22:6, we're told that they're archery experts, so they're very warlike, and it's important to recognize they were archery experts because the prophecy deals with that in part. And this is an end times prophecy, and I'll be evidencing why I believe it is, why it hasn't found fulfillment yet. And the prophecies are in Isaiah 11:11 and in Jeremiah 25:17 through 29. You can find out that Elam shows up in the end times, as it does in the prophecy I'm about to tell you. So if it is unfulfilled, it looks like it's about to be fulfilled in the very near future. So where this is, Elam was a smaller portion. You can see the arrow pointing to it. Persia was the major portion. And today, the Bushehr nuclear plant, which is loaded with Russian fuel rods, is in the heart of Elam, right where that arrow is pointing. Now, when those fuel rods were loaded into this power plant, this nuclear place, in the summer of 2010, former UN Ambassador John Bolton said that Israel's ability to strike this site now was pretty much, the window was closed, because it created a serious nuclear disaster if they strike right now. So most analysts these days are not really asking, will Israel strike Iran anymore, but when will Israel strike Iran? And how will Israel strike Iran? But I'm going to pose to you the possibility that they might even create a nuclear disaster, and that may have been predicted by Jeremiah. So I'll introduce this to you and let you guys see what you think about that. So that's where Elam was in comparison. Now, we know Ezekiel talked clearly about Persia in Ezekiel 38, verses 2 through 5. Son of man, set your face against Gog of the land of Magog, the prince of Rosh, Meshech, and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Gog, the prince of Rosh, Meshech, and Tubal. I will turn you around, put hooks in your jaws, lead you out with your army, horses and horsemen, all splendidly clothed, a great company of bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Persia, Ethiopia, and Libya are with them, all of them with shield and helmet, meaning it's a military situation with Persia being involved. Now, I will put the scriptures on the TV for you so that you can don't have to race through them, because I'm going to cover quite a bit of territory. But you can see clearly, I've emphasized in the gold font, Meshech and Tubal and Persia. These are participants in the Gog of Magog invasion of Ezekiel 38. And so quite clearly, Ezekiel is familiar with those three populations. So there they are on a map, where they would be, Meshech and Tubal and Persia. Now it's really interesting that it looks like Ezekiel was familiar with Elam at his time. Jeremiah wrote at the same time that Ezekiel wrote. But he purposely seems to have omitted Elam from this prophecy. And we know he's familiar with Elam because we're told in another chapter of Ezekiel, chapter 32, verses 24, there is Elam and all her multitude, all around her grave, all of them slain, fallen by the sword, who have gone down uncircumcised to the lower parts of the earth, who caused their terror in the land of the living. Now they bear their shame with those who go down to the pit. And then in the couple passages later, he connects with Meshech and Tubal. There are Meshech and Tubal and all their multitudes with all their graves around it, and all of them uncircumcised, slain by the sword, though they cause terror in the land of the living. Now, Ezekiel 32 is dealing with laments and judgments. It starts out with Egypt, and then it goes to Assyria, and then it's still Elam up there. Oh, that was the other passage I just read on Meshech and Tubal. And then he gets into Meshech and Tubal. Now, since Meshech and Tubal end up in Ezekiel 38 and 39, this prophecy in Ezekiel 32, verse 26, finds fulfillment after Ezekiel 38 and 39, as a result of Ezekiel 38 and 39, regarding Meshech and Tubal. But what about Elam? So Ezekiel is very familiar with Elam. He's very familiar with Meshech and Tubal. But he does not include Elam in the Gog and Magog invasion. Why not? Well, probably for the same reason. He does not include the Psalm 83 nations that are listed right here. It's interesting that he's very definitive about who he includes in Ezekiel 38 and 39, Togarma, Meshech, Tubal, etc. But he does not include by their ancient names, Ammon, Moab, Edom, Amalek, Philistia, these participants in Psalm 83. He does not include them. It's interesting, but if you read through all of his chapters, Ezekiel's chapters, he mentions Edom, Edomites, Moab, Moabites, Ammon, Ammonites, every one of these populations, even Gabal up there in the top. He lists them a total of 89 times, but he doesn't list them in Ezekiel 38. So he's very familiar with them. He doesn't list them probably because they're not involved in the prophecy. The Ezekiel 38 and 39 prophecy is very descriptive. 52 passages of every kind of detail you would want to know about this prophecy. And he's listed 9 specific populations, and he's omitted the 10 populations of Psalm 83, and he's omitted Elam. I think he has intentionally done that because they're not participating in Ezekiel 38 and 39. So what is this prophecy? So there's the 89 times it's listed. What is this prophecy? Well, it's in Jeremiah. We'll start in Jeremiah 49, verses 34 through 36. The word of the Lord, that came to Jeremiah the prophet against Elam in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, king of Judah, saying, Thus says the Lord of hosts, Behold, I will break the bow of Elam, the foremost of their might. Against Elam I will bring the four winds from the four quarters of heaven and scatter them. Toward all those winds there shall be no nations where the outcasts of Elam will not go. And we keep reading, verses 37 through 39. For I will cause Elam to be dismayed before their enemies, and before those who seek their life I will bring disaster upon them. My fierce anger, says the Lord, I will send the sword, which would be representing a military campaign, after them until I have consumed them. I will set my throne in Elam. I will destroy from there the king and the princes, says the Lord. But it shall come to pass in the latter days that I will bring back the captives of Elam, says the Lord. So there we have another reference to a connection to the latter days. And the good news for Iran is that there will be captives that will be brought back and they will go into the Messianic kingdom. Some Iranians will go into the Messianic kingdom. Now, let's break this down and analyze these prophecies, these supposedly latter-day prophecies. The very first thing I want to bring to your attention on line 5 up here is I've highlighted that they have fiercely angered the Lord. Okay, because the Lord does not random judgments without just cause. And Israel exists today in fulfillment of Bible prophecy. The Lord has big plans for little Israel. He's going to uphold his holy name in the midst of his people Israel in the Ezekiel 38 and 39 battle when he defeats those invaders. So he has big plans for little Israel. He is regathering them in the land. It's a miracle of God. And Ahmadinejad and Ayatollah Khomeini and the mullahs want to wipe Israel off the map. This is a statement Ahmadinejad made in October 2005, and the sad sentiment has been echoed many, many times since. So God has plans for Israel. Iran wants to wipe them off the map, and their main nuclear facility right now is loaded with Russian fuel rods in Elam. So they fiercely angered the Lord, and I think this has got something to do with what we're experiencing today, with their hostile attitude toward Israel. Benjamin Netanyahu has been saying for many years now that Israel's greatest existential threat is Iran, and especially their nuclear program. And it's coming to a head, people. It's coming to a head, and it may be this year, like Barak, the Secretary of Defense of Israel, said, that they deal with Iran's nuclear program. So they want to break the bow of Elam, strike them at the foremost of their might. That's the first thing that he talks about. When you break the bow of Elam, you take away their launching capabilities. They were expert archers, according to Isaiah 22. If you strike them at the foremost of their might, if that were to happen today, that would undoubtedly be their nuclear program. Because once they get a nuclear weapon, that would be the strongest weapon they would have in their arsenal. Then he says he's going to bring the four winds from the four quarters of heaven and scatter them toward all those winds. So there'll be a worldwide dispersion of the people affected in the area. And is that potentially a radioactive disaster? Does something go wrong and creates a scattering? And it says there'll be no nation where the outcasts of Elam do not go. Then he says Elam will be dismayed before their enemies and those who seek their life. Well, presently Iran has quite a few people upset with them. There's a bunch of sanctions levied against them from Europe, from America. Saudi Arabia is not happy with Iran's push to get a nuclear weapon and shift the power of the Middle East region into the Shiite crescent they want to form. So there's many people upset with Iran, and they're all going to see this disaster. Okay, so then he says, I'll bring disaster upon them, my fierce anger. I'll set the sword after them until I've consumed them. So it speaks of a military scenario. And I'll set my throne in Elam. The Hebrew word there really is probably more indicative of I'll have authority over the area. And I'll destroy the kings and princes, whether that means Ahmadinejad and whatnot, or maybe the local municipalities and whatnot, governors over there. I don't exactly know. But Ezekiel 38 makes it clear that Iran, in part, survives because they are part of Ezekiel 38 and 39. But it does not appear their Elam prophecies are in tandem with Ezekiel 38 and 39 because he did not include Elam. So you follow me so far? The distinctions here. And then he says, in the latter days I will bring back the captives of Elam. And again, I said Isaiah 11:11 and Jeremiah 25, verses 17 through 29, in conjunction with this last passage of Jeremiah 49, verse 39, alludes to an end times prophecy. Now, how many of you have heard that Jeremiah might have predicted a strike on Iran's nuclear sites? Exactly. So we want to be careful about this because it's new information. Joe Rosenberg's starting to talk about it. Bill Koenig is starting to talk about it, if you know who these guys are. Joel Rosenberg writes extensively about Ezekiel 38 and 39. So this sounds almost so sensational that this could happen, and there's so much description here that we do have to be careful it's not newspaper exegesis. But again, Bible prophecy gives us great details, and if it's about to happen, and we can see it shaping up right now, then we shouldn't be shocked if there's these kind of details here for us. So it looks like we know Israel's going to strike Iran's nuclear sites. It really appears that way right now. I will also say, and I write two extensive chapters on this in Revelation Road, this whole commentary, much more detail than I can do in this presentation, but Iran is 90% seismic. Most of Iran sits on earthquake faults and things like that. So what causes this disaster? It looks like it's a military thing. Maybe it's a earthquake scenario or something. So we have to keep that option in play. So that is the prophecies of Elam. Now I want to shift our attention to Syria for a minute. As you know, Syria has been in a revolution for about 16 months now, and it's getting really, really bad over there. And there happens to be several important Bible prophecies concerning Damascus and Syria proper. So we're going to touch upon those a little bit right now. Now, Bashar Assad was born in September 11, 911-1965. He was 16 years old when his father, Hafez Assad, killed 10 to 20,000 of his countrymen in the fourth largest city of Syria called Hama, as he crunched out a revolution at his time. Now, he has been fighting quite a serious war, and he has moved weapons up earlier, actually when the Arab Spring started, around the early part of 2011, he moved a bunch of his weapons up to a city called Homs. And I'm going to show you where that is on a map in just a moment. And that's where a lot of the revolution went, and the weapons were there, and the revolutionaries knew the weapons were there, the rebels. And so this is sort of where it started to go. Now, at this point in time, when this article came out, it says, as Syria hits city, UN says toll climbs to 8,500. Well, now they're estimating it's between 16,000 to 17,000 have been killed since this article came out. All the attempts of the Arab League and Kofi Annan, the former UN president, have failed, and it's really getting grim over there in Syria right now. Russia and China are pro-Syrian government, and America and much of the West wants Bashar Assad out of there. And so it's a real quagmire, because you've got almost a Cold War that could develop if we're not careful. Now today, I'm going to show you where Homs is, because it's important. Syria has Scud-D missiles. These are some of the missiles they moved up to Homs. You can see Homs up there. It's right on the border of Lebanon. And Hassan Nasrallah, it's suspected, has some of these Scud-Ds now, that some of those weapons made their way into Hezbollah's hands. Now, a Scud-D can go, it can shoot 400 miles, so it could go from anywhere in northern Syria to anywhere in southern Israel, and it could land within 20 yards accuracy. Now, when Saddam Hussein shot his Scud missiles into Israel during Desert Storm, those were Scud A's, and those were really very indiscriminate. You don't know where they're going to land. These, you know where they're going to land. And they can hit their target, and Hezbollah and Syria has a bank of targets. They're very familiar with what they could hit. They can also be laced with chemicals. And what is interesting, as of yesterday, Syria was moving a lot of its chemical weapons, which they have an untold number of sarin and cyanide and mustard gas chemical weapons, maybe one of the largest arsenals in the world of chemical weapons. They are now moving some of them around out of storage, and this is getting a lot of attention. This is as of yesterday. And the concern is they're going to use them in ethnic cleansing against the rebels. And some people say, well, no, they're just moving them because they want to protect them from the rebels. But I'm going to tell you now, Jack Kinsella is a friend. Who all know, who've heard of Jack Kinsella? He writes the Omega Report. He writes Hal Lindsey's TV show. He sent out in his Omega News Report today, I'm going to run this by you. He says that what probably could happen, this is the greater concern from a prophetic perspective, is that Syria, Bashar Assad will use these chemical weapons on the rebels to try to provoke international intervention, and there'd be a war coming against Syria, which would then attack Israel as a response to that. And in so doing, they would draw Hezbollah and Iran and Hamas into the conflict. So that's what Jack says is a possible scenario, which in reality, that's what I wrote about in Revelation Road, you know, pretty much that type of scenario that could happen. Now that takes on a new meaning when we think about what Bashar Assad has seen. And in the Arab Spring, he has seen Ben Ali, who reigned in Tunisia for 23 years, be deposed. He saw Mubarak get deposed and get thrown in prison. And many of us think Mubarak is actually dead at this point in time. He reigned over Egypt for 30 years. He saw bin Laden, who was an Arab leader. He saw Anwar al-Awlaki, both of them get assassinated. He saw Gaddafi take a bullet to the head. And he also saw Ali Abdullah Saleh, who reigned for 34 years over Yemen, be deposed during the Arab Spring. And I'll be talking more about that in my talk tomorrow. And it's not so much who's gone, but who's still left behind. Ahmadinejad, Khomeini, Assad, Hassan Nasrallah, and those guys that really hate Israel. So anyway, he's seen all this happen. Now, there was a time, see, Turkey's very concerned. They share a common border with Syria. And they're very concerned about this violence in Syria because they're getting flooded with refugees. And Turkey's a member of NATO. So they have asked, they wanted NATO to get involved like NATO got involved in Libya. And this came out around the end of 2011. And when this information came out that NATO ought to get involved in this revolution in Syria, Bashar Assad was very concerned, the president of Syria, and he said this: if a crazy measure is taken against Damascus, I will need not more than 6 hours to transfer hundreds of rockets and missiles to the Golan Heights to fire them at Tel Aviv. So here's specifically what his plan was, and it was very precise, 6 hours. The first 3 hours, he was going to have Hezbollah fire missiles into Tel Aviv. And the next 3 hours, he was going to have Iran get together and protect the Persian Gulf from Western warships and intervention. Very specific plan to throw missiles into Tel Aviv. Israel's response was, because Israel can't fight a war of attrition, they would have to act decisively and expeditiously, and that was to attack Damascus. Okay, now when we hear that, it should raise our eyebrows to think about some important prophecies written centuries ago about the capital city of Damascus, the oldest continuously inhabited city in recorded history. The capital of Syria is Damascus. Isaiah 17:1 says, the burden against Damascus, behold, Damascus will cease from being a city, and it will be a ruinous heap. Now, some people say that Damascus, this prophecy, was fulfilled in 732 BC by the Assyrian Empire. And a good friend of mine, Dr. Mark Hitchcock, believes this, and he writes that in his book, Middle East Burning. But I have said to Mark that I strongly disagree. And it says Isaiah, in his 66 chapters, speaks about Assyria 37 times, but doesn't mention them once in this prophecy, and all 14 verses of Isaiah 17. In fact, what Isaiah does seem to talk about is that Israel, in self-defense, is responsible for the destruction of Damascus, because we find in verse 9 that in that day his strong cities, speaking of Damascus in the masculine pronoun, his strong cities will be as a forsaken bough, and an uppermost branch, which they left because of the children of Israel, and there will be desolation. So the children of Israel are mentioned amidst the discussion of desolation. So that's interesting. It's not Assyria that seems to be responsible, but Israel. And what else is very interesting is in verse 14, it says, behold, at eventide trouble, and there and before the morning he is no more. This is the portion of those who plunder us and the lot of those who rob us. So one evening you see Damascus. And remember, Damascus goes back almost 5,000 years. It predates the time of Abraham. And in the morning you don't see it anymore. It was like, if you remember that tsunami in Japan from the earthquake, that city, those cities that were affected were just fine the night before, but in the next morning they were gone. Well, Israel has the weapons capability to destroy Damascus overnight. Okay? So this is a very real possibility. And if Israel strikes Iran, and if that Elam prophecy that I mentioned earlier happens, Iran is not just going to roll over and take it. They're going to call upon their proxies, Syria, Hezbollah, and Hamas, to engage with Israel. That would be my thought for you on that. Now, the other reason I don't believe this prophecy found fulfillment is because 200 or so years later, Jeremiah, a Hebrew prophet writes about it in Jeremiah 49, verses 23 through 27. So if it was already fulfilled, Damascus has to regain itself, rebuild itself, so that Jeremiah's later prophecy can find fulfillment. So I put the two together, to be quite honest with you. I think we're just getting more details about Isaiah 17 through Jeremiah 49, verses 23 through 27. And it starts out, against Damascus, Hamath and Arpad are shamed. For they have heard bad news, they are faint-hearted, there is trouble on the sea, it cannot be quiet. Damascus has grown feeble. She turns to flee, and fear has seized her. Anguish and sorrows have taken her like a woman in labor. Now, just briefly, Hamath and Arpad were very populated, well-known cities in ancient times, and they were more toward the northern area of Syria, around Aleppo, which is the number one populated city in Syria today, and around Homs, which is the number three populated city today. Damascus is number two. So this is interesting. You can see that all of Syria seems to be coming under an assault here. And I'll be breaking this down for you in just a minute. But in the midst of this prophecy against Damascus, Jeremiah asks a very interesting rhetorical question. And I'm going to throw in the words, by the way. Why is the city of praise not deserted, the city of my joy? Well, that would be Jerusalem. That is the city of praise of God's joy. So for some reason, Jeremiah feels it important to say, look, Damascus is going down. It's being doomed. But, oh, look, Jerusalem. It's not destroyed. Okay, remember, God doesn't levy judgments without just cause. And he has foreign policy in Genesis 12:3 that he'll bless those who bless Israel, he'll curse those who curse them. Something must be happening where they're trying to take over Jerusalem or do something to Jerusalem, and they're not effective, but in retaliation, they get judged. It gets worse. It says, therefore her young men shall fall in her streets. That would be civilian casualties. And all the men of war shall be cut off in that day, says the Lord of hosts. I will kindle a fire in the wall of Damascus, and it shall consume the palaces of Ben-Hadad. Here's where Arpad and Hamath are that I told you about earlier, up in northern Syria. Damascus, as you can see, is down there. So what is this that we've got? Let's break this down, because this is a very important prophecy. Things go from bad to worse in this prophecy with Jeremiah. They hear bad news. It makes them faint-hearted. There's trouble on the sea, and it cannot be quiet. Well, the Mediterranean Sea presently has three Dolphin-class submarines that can launch nuclear weapons well into many cities in the Middle East, including Damascus. They're going to get three more, and they're going to have those over the next year or two. And the sixth one that they get is going to be unbelievable. It's presently being built in Germany, and it is around, it's being guarded heavily militarily because of the technologies that are involved in it. But the ones they have presently could still nuke Damascus. Is it possible Jeremiah is saying something is being launched from the sea and it's coming into Damascus? And Damascus grows very feeble and turns to flee because fear has seized her like a woman in labor. And then you have the casualties hit. And Damascus, if this is connected with Isaiah 17, pretty much many, many people will be wiped out. There's a couple million people, maybe 2 to 3 million, in and around Damascus. Now, if this were to happen, folks, in your lifetime, not just to mention potentially this year, because that's how bizarre it's getting over there right now, what do you think would happen if you woke up and all of a sudden the oldest city in recorded history is just leveled and gone, worse than Hiroshima, and that sort of thing? This would be a major, major situation. It would draw the whole Middle East into a war, because of the other capital cities, Cairo and whatnot, would be concerned that they might be next. Okay, while Israel's at it, why don't we just take out somebody else too? And I think this could actually lead to Psalm 83. And that's the scenario I put through in Revelation Road. Now, Damascus's destruction could be before Psalm 83, or it could be inside of Psalm 83. And as I explain Psalm 83 more to you, tomorrow especially, you'll see how that could all interplay. There's another very interesting prophecy in Amos, chapter 1, verses 3 through 4. Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Damascus and for four, I will not turn away its punishment because they have threshed Gilead with implements of iron, but I will send fire into the house of Hazael, which shall devour the palaces of Ben-Hadad, which is pretty much what the end of Jeremiah 49, verse 27 said. Some people believe, and I think this they could be correct, that the three transgressions, the first one was the 1948 Arab-Israeli War that involved Syria. The second one would be the 1967 war, the Six-Day War, when Syria and Jordan and Egypt attacked Israel, and Israel won in 6 days. And then the third transgression would be the Yom Kippur War, when they wanted to get that land back that Israel took in 1967 and were defeated in the Yom Kippur War. So for three transgressions, but for four, Damascus gets destroyed. Four, I believe, could be the Psalm 83 war. Because Syria finds itself involved under the banner of Assyria in Psalm 83, and I'll be going through those populations tomorrow. Assyria back then would involve northern Iraq and Syria. Syria is involved in Psalm 83, which I believe is a process in progress right now. And I think it's very important that we understand that, because I think America has something a lot to do with the responsibility of what's going on in Israel today, the rights we were given as the most blessed nation since the United Kingdom fell, when the sun used to never sit on it. I believe that America should be very aware of what's going on right now, because we have a responsibility to Israel at this point in time, as per the purposes of God. So it's a prophecy in process, and for those of you that are not familiar with it, you have a confederacy that gets together, that wants to come together and cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be remembered no more. The populations are listed up there on the right, and they're the nations that I showed you the map on earlier that share common borders with Israel, including the terrorist populations, Hezbollah, Palestinian refugees, Hamas, etc. Okay, so let me explain. If you've been watching closely and understand Psalm 83, you should be able to realize that this prophecy is about to find final fulfillment. And I compare it to the rebirth of the nation Israel. One morning, the world woke up on May 14th, 1948, and the nation of Israel existed. But if you were paying attention, you could have known for about 50-some years that that was going to happen. And the goal of Psalm 83 is they wanted one more Arab state, and they want to call it Palestine, is really what it appears to be. This prophecy is about to find fulfillment. So let's compare this to 1948 with the rebirth of the nation Israel. Theodor Herzl, often considered the father of Zionism, he writes in a diary, he wrote the book called Der Judenstaat, which means the Jewish state, and in his book, just so you know, it was his feelings that anti-Semitism was growing so much worldwide, and especially in Europe, that the only way the Jews could escape it was to go back to their homeland, or to have a homeland, and to get back to it. So he writes in his diary at Basel, which is where they hosted the first Zionist Congress, I founded the Jewish state. If I said this out loud today, I would be answered by universal laughter, if not in 5 years. Certainly in 50, everyone will know it. Well, he said that 50 years before Israel gained its statehood and the partition plan of 1947. So it was a prophecy, but he didn't even really know it. I mean, he said 50 years, and it just turns out that's exactly when it was. Now, at the time, Britain, the sun never used to set on the British Empire. And I'm going to explain to you how God deals with the nations, because I think it's important to realize what happened to Britain for them foregoing their responsibility to this process. And around 1917, the Lord Balfour came out with a declaration, and it's written up here, His Majesty's government view with favor the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people. So the goal was, and they were given authorization, to establish a Jewish state after World War I, because the Turks had ruled over the Middle East for 400 years, but they chose the wrong side and got defeated in World War I. So now Britain and France were given charge over the area, and Lord Balfour was going to give authorize a Jewish state, and he was given the privilege to do that. Now, this is much bigger than his own prime minister at the time. This is a God-ordained thing. This was the greatest empire that had ever lived at that time. The sun never used to set on the British Empire. And they were victorious, and they were to bring the Jews back into this big chunk of land, which I'm going to show you a map in just a minute. There it is. This is the land they were supposed to have gotten. You can see it's much larger than Israel today. It encompassed all of Israel today and all of Jordan today. This was around 1917. This was supposed to happen. God was authorizing them, in my estimation, to go forward and do this. Now, how does God deal with the nations? God establishes nations and defines their boundaries. We're told that God, in Acts 17, 26, God made from one every nation of mankind, having determined their appointing times and the boundaries of their habitation. God also determines when a nation will cease to exist. And God has a purpose for each nation, both general and specific. With the British Empire, I believe it was to implement the reinstatement of the nation of Israel, one of their main purposes. They were blessed. They were all over the world at the time. Additionally, God blesses and disciplines nations in accordance with their obedience to him and their treatment of the Jewish people. And we know in Genesis 12:3, I quoted it earlier, that I would make you a great nation, I'll bless you, and I'll bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. God's foreign policy established for the Gentile nations 4,000 years ago when he made a covenant with Abraham, promised him to be a great nation. It extrapolates through Isaac and Jacob and the Jewish people today. And now, they were supposed to bless Israel, and they were supposed to give them this land, but God also holds nations in contempt because of their pride and rebellion, and because they serve as idols. Okay, so in my estimation, think about this, the UK, where the sun never used to set on its empire, had the obligation to give Israel that land. It was not only permitted by the prime minister and everyone in the international community. Now also, what happened in God's sovereignty, just so you know, after the Ottoman Empire was collapsed, they went through and they established all the Arab states, and here's a list of Afghanistan in 1919, Egypt 1922, and they were put back in the places where they sort of used to have borders when they're ancient countries, and Persia became called Iran in 1935. So you can see the sovereign work of God is going on. The Middle East is freed up from the Islamic Caliphate, the Ottoman Empire. Britain and France have charge over the Middle East. The Arab states and the Persian countries are brought back in. And so you see this was all working quite well, and Israel could be brought back to their land in fulfillment of numerous Bible prophecies. And this is what the British Empire looked like at the time, if you can see it. The sun never used to set on the British Empire. They were on almost every continent, and that's why the sun could never set on it. That was in 1917, 1920. But they didn't give Israel that land. Because the Arabs came to the Brits and said, we helped you win against the Ottoman Empire. We need another Arab state. You owe us. So they gave away Jordan to what is now called the area of Jordan. That used to be ancient Moab, Ammon, and Edom. In so doing, they subjected the Jewish people to the horrors of the Holocaust through World War II and the madman Hitler. And then after World War II, the United Nations forms and they declare UN Resolution 181, the partition plan, and this is the small notch of land, is what they called it, that Israel got. And you can see in the two different colors up there that it was for an Arab and a Jewish state. Now we're talking about a state here that's no longer, that's not much bigger than the size of New Jersey. God gave Abraham the land from the river of Egypt, which would be the Nile, to the river Euphrates, which is at least 10 times as big as what Israel occupies presently. So this is what Israel gets. They were supposed to get much more, but this is what they get. And they will get more, by the way. They already took more in 1967. And even though the world opposes Israel in many ways from expanding or having the settlements, and they consider it an occupation of the settlements of supposed Palestinian lands and all that, Israel is growing. That's the interesting thing, because God is for that. So then Israel becomes a nation. This is what the British Empire looked like then. This is what the British Empire looks like right now. Nothing. There's nothing. It's not blessed anymore. I spoke over there a couple years ago, and I was shocked to see that probably 90% of the churches over there are replacement theology. They don't even think Israel has a right to exist. Look how far they've fallen. Okay. Now, I want to take just a moment to tell you that I think most of you in here probably realize that Israel exists today in fulfillment of Bible prophecy. You're not burdened by replacement theology or supersessionism. Joseph Farah quoted this yesterday. I'm not going to quote all the prophecies that Israel fulfilled by coming into the homeland now, the restoration prophecies, but I want to tell you that the existence of Israel today is a bigger miracle than the parting of the Red Seas. And we know from Jeremiah 23, verses 7 through 8, "Therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that they shall no longer say, as the Lord lives, who brought up the children of Israel from the land of Egypt, but as the Lord lives, who brought up and led the descendants of the house of Israel from the north country and from all the countries where I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land." So in other words, it's the bigger miracle. It's the regathering. It's momentous. We should give the Lord a standing ovation that he has done this. He had to free up the Middle East so that this could happen. It's a big deal. There's Isaiah 11:11 talks about it. There's probably about a dozen prophecies at least that talks about the regathering of the nation of Israel. But let's look at it from what it takes from a sovereign position to restore the nation of Israel. Now remember, during the Red Sea, Pharaoh, the Hebrews were backed up against the Red Sea, and Pharaoh was marching against them, and the Lord had to put a pillar, a tempest before Pharaoh, so the Hebrews could all get ready to go through the Red Sea. And then he parted the Red Sea, and they went through it, and then the Pharaoh's army came after them. So Pharaoh's army was trying to destroy the Israelites at the Red Sea, curse the Israelites right there. The Israelites go through the Red Sea, Pharaoh's army comes into the Red Sea, and it collapses on them, and they all die. So they got cursed for curse and kind. They tried to destroy Israel, but they got destroyed. That's God's foreign policy out of Genesis 12, verse 3. Okay? That was a big deal, parting the Red Seas. No one's ever done it since. But, okay, but he also had to prevent Nazi genocide because Hitler wanted to wipe them out. He had to empower the Allied forces to do that. He had to implant Zionism into the hearts of the Jewish people, which he started around the time of Theodor Herzl in 1896. Remember, these Jews had been out in the nations of the world for over 1,800 years, different cultures, different languages. You know, it was no easy undertaking to want to have Jews come back into, which was a desolate area at the time. He had to create Arab homeland so that to get the Arabs and the Persians out of the area so that they could get Jews in there. He had to create the Jewish state, which, of course, was legislated in the UN Resolution 181. Now he's had to empower the Israeli army to protect Israel from the Arab wars that have come against them and from the wars that are about to come against them. And so that was no easy undertaking. And I point out in both my books that the Israeli Defense Forces exist today in fulfillment of Bible prophecy. I point out the passages where you can find that. And they really only exist for one primary purpose, and that's to defeat the Arab War of Psalm 83. Because they're not involved in the defeat of the Gog and Magog invasion in Ezekiel 38. God stops that. And they're not involved in the Armageddon campaign when the Antichrist brings the armies of the world down against Israel, because Jesus comes and stops that. So the IDF really is only that instrumental for this time, right now, this moment, this season. And then he had to preserve and prosper Israel, because Israel is going to exist and they're going to be very prosperous. And Russia is going to form its coalition in Ezekiel 38 and 39 with Iran and Ethiopia and Turkey and whatnot to come against that Israel that's very prosperous. I'll be really going over that, unpacking that tomorrow. So Israel becomes a nation in 1948, and what's the first thing that happens is the Arabs come against the Jews. And what they told the Arab states, told the Arabs that were living in what was then called Palestine, to get out. We need you out of the area for 5 days, because we're going to go, this isn't going to happen. We're going to take out Israel. We're going to destroy them, and you can go back and take over their communities, and you can have your own Palestine state. But that was a terrible miscalculation. I spoke with General Shimon Aram. He's retired now. He fought in every one of those wars. And he told me, he said, "Bill, the first war in 1948, they had advanced fighter jets coming against us from all different angles, and we had a few private planes with some hand grenades and some glass milk bottles. And we were just dropping them and they won that war. And every one of the wars they won were David and Goliath victories." Okay. And I'm going to be hammering home on that a little bit more tomorrow. But what happened during that miscalculation is you had a refugee crisis develop. All of a sudden, the Arabs of Palestine now became called the Palestinian refugees, because that land became called Israel. The Palestinian refugees, I believe they show up in Psalm 83 as the tents of Edom. And I do the whole genealogy of that in my book, Israelistine, and I'll be going over that more tomorrow. So that was the first war. You have the refugees now. Their plight is a big deal. The tents of Edom, they show up first in Psalm 83 among the populations. They became a reality when Israel became a nation. Psalm 83 became the start of a process, because Psalm 83 really banners the tents of Edom, the Palestinian refugees and their plight for one more Arab state. The Arabs want to destroy Israel so that they can have one more state over there called Palestine. So then you had the wars again. You can see that Psalm 83 is developing, 1967 war, 1973 war. They're going to have a climactic concluding Arab-Israeli war, according to Psalm 83, is how I interpret that. And that, to me, folks, is about to happen. And that's about to happen before Ezekiel 38, and I'll tell you why I believe that tomorrow. That's in my books. So Psalm 83 is a prophecy in process, like Israel was a prophecy in process. People paying attention could see that Israel was coming. People paying attention can see that Psalm 83 is coming. Why is that important? I don't want to go through these. I don't have time. I will say this, though. Remember that, according to Zechariah 2:8, Israel is the apple of God's eye. And Satan's plan, through Islam and through all these other genocidal attempts he's had through time, has been to destroy the Jewish people. And they're trying to do, the Arab Confederacy of Psalm 83 is going to try to destroy the Jews and try to take away their land. Remember that the Abrahamic covenant, God promised Israel would be a great nation. A great nation needs people, so he promised them he'd have descendants forever. People need a land, so he gave them a promised land. Satan is trying to destroy the Jews and take away the land. That is a satanic spiritual warfare that's really going on. It's a classic battle of good and evil, and it's going to play out in Psalm 83 in the Middle East. Destroy the Jews, take the land, prove God's a promise breaker. If there's no more Jews, then there'll be no Jew to say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, which is a mandate of Christ's second return. So he doesn't want Jesus to return, and he wants to prove God is a promise breaker, not a covenant keeper. And he's going to try to do that through the Arab-Israeli War of Psalm 83. Now, why is that important to America? I told you that each country has a purpose, that God establishes a country for purposes. And America's two purposes, one was to become a beacon of Christianity to the world, and we have been that in many instances and sent out missionaries throughout the world, but also to be a safe haven for the Jewish people and to be involved in the reestablishment of the nation of Israel. And our president at the time, Harry S. Truman, who won a shocking defeat of John Dewey in 1947, was pro-Israel. He was one of the leaders, one of the instrumental leaders in establishing the reestablishment of the nation of Israel. And you see him there with the first president of Israel, Chaim Weizmann. And he got a Torah, which was a traditional gift given to a leader. So he said, I had always wanted one of those. So we were important at that point in time. We were used by the Lord. We were a blessed country. The British Empire is declining, but we're on the rise after these wars. Our country is being blessed. But what's going on these days? We are trying to get give God's land back to the Arabs. We are trying to do land for peace deals, two-state solutions. Folks, the Arabs don't want peace with the Jews. They want peace without the Jews. They don't want a two-state solution. They want one more state. They want to call it Palestine. It's been coming quite obvious, and it's been 64 years since Israel became a nation, and I think the Arab Spring was sort of the tipping point where the Lord was saying to us, okay, it's been 64 years. It's gotten worse. Now the enemies of Israel can wipe it off the map. They have the weapons to wipe it off the map, and they want to wipe it off the map, so I'm going to intervene. And I think you're going to see that happen. And if you want to know how that plays out, that'll be my topic tomorrow. But you have had, ever since George H. Bush on through to Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, trying to give away land deals. We're changing our position on Israel. And our president presently, who is incessant with bowing before Arab leaders, he embraces a Saudi peace plan, which calls for East Jerusalem to be the capital of a Palestinian state, that the Palestinian refugees could go back into Israel, and it's a land for peace deal. And so, you know, it's a very, very troubling situation. We're asking Israel to negotiate land for peace deals with countries that don't even want them to exist and populations that don't want them to. And why is that a big deal? Well, we're told in the end times, in Joel chapter 3, verse 2, when the Armageddon campaign happens and the Antichrist assembles the armies of the world to come against Israel, it says, I will bring all the nations and bring them down to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will enter into judgment with them there on account of my people, my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations. They have also divided up my land. So one of the very reasons God is going to judge the nations of the world in the very end times is for dividing up his land. And you know what, folks? We are one of the biggest proponents of doing that apart from the Arabs right now. So this doesn't bode very well for our situation. So what does this mean for America? I've had the opportunity to interview three excellent authors, prophetic voices of our time. They've recently been burdened to write about concerns about America. Dr. Mark Hitchcock wrote the book, The Late Great United States. Terry James wrote The American Apocalypse. And Dr. David Reagan wrote America the Beautiful. He actually revised it for his third edition. I've had the opportunity to interview them on the radio show, on my radio show, Prophecy Update Radio, read their books, and I've got some good and bad news. The good news is they all come up with the same consensus. The bad news is that's not very good news for us. Because their consensus is that America, if it's in Bible prophecy, is not the same superpower that we once knew and loved. America the Beautiful is someday not so bountiful. And that's of concern. Just like the British Empire, now the sun sets on it. What happens to our superpower status? Well, the sun set on it as well. Is America under judgment presently? How does this apply to the United States? We have to ask ourselves a few questions. Has money become our God? Has greed become our motivator? Have we kicked God out of our schools? Have we legalized abortion? Have we become the moral polluter of the earth? If the answer to all those is yes, then why wouldn't God judge America? Are we about to be judged? Interestingly, today, a good friend of mine, Jonathan Kahn, should be speaking here, which, by the way, I think he's going to be speaking an hour later now because his plane flight was delayed. So if you have an opportunity to, which is good news for me because I'm going to be in that room at 7:15 doing some TV thing. And I wanted to move it back because I wanted to see Jonathan. I spoke at his church about a month ago in New Jersey. So he's got an excellent book, and it's about judgment on America. It's a bestseller on the New York Times. So I encourage you to watch him tonight. But God issues remedial judgments before he issues the big blast on a country. And we have been experiencing remedial judgments in this country since September 11th when we saw the towers come down. And we've had three wars in the Middle East. We've had natural disasters. We've had economic upheavals. We've had Category 5 hurricanes in 2005. August, we had Katrina. We had Rita shortly after that in September. We've had record-breaking tornado seasons. I was speaking in Missouri when this was going on in April of 2011. They had one title was 3 days, 14 states, 241 tornadoes, and they've still had bad ones in, around the Dallas area and things even since. And ripping through all these states and leaving devastation in, in the aftermath. And, you know, there was tornadoes around the Fort Worth area. 650 homes were destroyed. That was just, you know, around April of this year. We've also had a mortgage meltdown in 2007. A global economic crisis in 2008, a BP oil spill in 2010, the most costliest disaster in our nation's history. Is God issuing remedial judgments? I do a whole spiel on this with greater detail. Actually, it's covered in my book, Revelation Road, also. But you can go to my website, prophecydepot.com, and you can see teachings, video teachings on the future of America there. God gives people the leaders they deserve. Is that why we have a president who says we are no longer only a Christian nation, but also a Jewish nation, a Muslim nation, and a Buddhist nation, and a Hindu nation, and a nation of non-believers? So have we gotten a leader that we deserve? Is this the change we wanted? Okay. So, you know, we are living in the midst of very important times. And I would summarize by basically saying that when Jesus spoke about end times events, he used the analogy of birth pains. So when the baby is about to be birthed, and in this instance we'll say the return of Jesus Christ, the contractions of a woman, of a mother, they become more intense and they become more frequent. And you can't stop them. And then the baby's birthed. So when the end times events start to happen, they start to happen with a lot of intensity and a lot of frequency, each one building powerfully upon another. Isaiah 17, the destruction of that is a very big deal, but it's not as big a deal as the destruction of all the other Arab populations in Psalm 83. And that's not as big a deal as the bigger outer circle destruction in Ezekiel 38 and 39. You know, and we've got all these other things that will happen, a harlot world religion, and so on and so forth, the one world order, the Antichrist has got to be revealed, and ultimately an Armageddon campaign. A lot of that we won't see here if you believe in a pre-trib rapture. But we're called at this point in time, and I always like to close with Luke 21:36. It says, "Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." Because we don't have, you know, we're going to escape God's wrath. And I think that's what he's saying here, that you don't endure all these things, or you don't escape some of these things, but you escape all of these things. Now, we won't necessarily escape man's wrath. There were Christians who died on September 11th. And we may be here for Psalm 83, and we may be here for the destruction of Damascus. And if those things happen, you could pretty much expect oil wars, stock market collapses, and all kinds of things, you know. So you want to be prepared for that. You want to be prayerful, and you want to be watchful. But I think what we need to recognize here also is that when we're watching, therefore, and praying always, we're trying to witness as best we can to those we love, our family members. What are they going through? They're all wrapped up in all kinds of weird things out there. These are just really difficult times, and they're all worried about their own situations and having a future and a hope and that sort of thing. What are we doing about that? Are we being involved in their life and trying to, when we can, bring their attention to what's going on in their world and find ways to connect that with Jesus and with the Bible and that sort of thing? That's the real art, and that's where it requires a lot of prayer. But folks, a lot of people are going to experience this stuff, and my goal in Revelation Road was to write to people these days to prepare for the rapture and for these events, but also for the people that get left behind. And Revelation Road is book one of a trilogy, and it ends with the rapture, but then I get into the people that get left behind in the second book, which is half done. Anyway, let's pray, and then I'll send you back out to the book tables. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity together. We live in very interesting times. Give us the courage to face these times. Help us to know how to witness and glorify Jesus in these times, especially around our loved ones. And Lord, use us, and help us to continue to grow and learn Bible prophecy, and to grow in Jesus. And we ask this in his name. Amen. All right, thank you very much.